Welcome in to It Just Means More Softball, part of the Softball America Podcast Network. I'm Gray Robertson alongside my partner, Tom Canterbury. We are back. We missed last week because we were working. Alabama and Florida were part of Monday Night Softball. Tonight, it's LSU Ole Miss. We have no professional obligation. So here we are. Tom, good to see you back on the same screen talking about the SEC.
Yes, excited. It's been a long time since we've been together discussing softball, so I'm very excited to be back with you.
And of course, if you're watching, we would love for you to like, subscribe, leave a review as long as it's nice. All that fun stuff. You know, subscribe to the YouTube page for Softball America. Check out all the shows. We've got all of the great stuff that Tim Walton and Nicole Mendez and Sydney Supley and Aaliyah Jordan and the rest of the gang are putting together. So check it out. The chat is also open. I've already seen one message pop in. Oh, it's from Jennifer C.
Who's that?
Do we know her?
Unfortunately, I've seen you a lot more than I've seen her recently.
I won't take that as offensive because I know that that's your wife. So normally we would start with the quick hits. We'd cover some of the teams and what's going on around the SEC. But no. Not when you've got an All-American in the house. We're starting off with a big bopper. We're doing this right out the gate. Our guest tonight from the Tennessee Lady Vols. I could spend the whole segment reading accolades. The All-American, last year first team, second team, she's been everywhere, multi-time All-SEC selection. She is currently third in the SEC in batting average, second in slugging, fourth in OBP, second in runs scored, third in hits, second in doubles, eighth in home runs, second in stolen bases. She is the graduate. She has done so many phenomenal things in her career, and we cannot wait to talk about all of them with her. It is Kiki Malloy. Kiki, welcome to the show. How are you?
Good. Thanks for having me on here. I'm excited.
We have got so much to talk about, Tom.
Not often we get to talk to somebody that we saw personally hit a home run into a dining tent from ESPN live and in person. And that happened.
Wow. Yeah. Wait,
so, Kiki, we've told your head coach, Karen Weekly, this story. Tom, do you want to let her know? I don't know, yeah. Kiki, if you're aware of what happened at the SEC tournament last year.
As you know, we're the Alabama radio guys, so we're doing the semifinal game in the SEC tournament. And the home run you hit into the parking lot, it rolls into that parking lot in Fayetteville toward the tent that ESPN has set up. And a guy walks out of the tent holding his chicken fingers or whatever was on his plate. And just looks and watches the ball roll into the tent. It was one of the funniest things I've ever seen.
That was a far one. That was a far one.
It went a while. It went a while.
Exactly.
Have you hit anything? Have you hit home runs before like that one? Or I'm sure you have in your career where you were just like, wow, that's going to break somebody's car.
Yes, I have. But, you know, as long as it just goes over the fence, I don't really care how far it goes because the home run's a home run, right?
That's exactly right. Well, hey, we want to talk about what your team and what you accomplished this past weekend against Missouri. That was a good Missouri team who ended in Knoxville, and you swept them. And frankly, none of the games are really particularly close. It was just a dominant performance by the Lady Vols. Mm-hmm. What was the difference for the offense in particular and for you that made you so sharp against that pitching staff all weekend long?
I think just coming off of our midweek game at Howard, I mean, obviously we scored, I think, 11 runs, but we did not have the game, the complete game that we wanted to. So we kind of talked about that and just what we need to do better coming into that weekend. Obviously, the first night we had our bats were hot, but that's just because everyone was bought into the process. Everyone was attacking as soon as they got into the box, like no passive swings, nothing like that. We kind of just carried that on throughout the entire weekend to get that sweep. And then our pitching was outstanding. We had phenomenal pitching and just lockdown defense, but just all the pieces clicking at the right time.
You guys have won 14 in a row since the loss to UCLA at the Mary Nutter. Mm-hmm. What has kind of clicked and come together since then?
I think at Mary Nutter, we had some losses that, or just in preseason, like we played a lot of good teams in the preseason. And so having those good teams and experiencing what it's going to be like once we do hit pro postseason, and kind of working through a couple of things and moving into the rest of preseason and then our first week of SEC, we kind of knew what we needed to fine tune. So just having that good competition up front helped.
Kiki, I want to talk about your game for a second because you've set such an incredibly high standard for yourself with the success, and you got off to kind of a quote unquote slower start to the year.
Right.
So far in March, you are hitting .595. What is it that has turned around these last few weeks for you to where you're now just seeing the ball as well as anybody in America?
I mean, I think just in past years, it's always just been a slow start, just kind of getting back together. It was a little bit slower than it normally has been, but that's the fun part about softball is just like constantly tweaking things and constantly like reinventing yourself, but falling back on what you know. So I think I just had to, one, calm down a little bit because, striking out is not the worst thing in the world and getting out is not the worst thing in the world, especially when you're facing pitchers that are probably going to be All-Americans at the end of the season. So just understanding that and then moving forward.
You mentioned a little while ago how well that your pitchers have been pitching for you on Tennessee this year. How much does it help you offensively knowing that you have two elite pitchers that are not going to give up a whole lot on their side?
Yeah, I think it kind of goes back and forth because us as an offense, like we know we're an elite offense, so as many runs as we can get for our pitchers just to give them that extra padding so that they can work their spin through the zone, they can feel comfortable going in there, and then for them holding runs for us, like if we're struggling that day at the plate, we know like we're going to be solid on both sides and we got each other's backs.
Mm-hmm. This is now the third season. Kiki Malloy is our guest, by the way, if you're just tuning in. This is the third season that Chris Malveaux has been on staff at Tennessee, and it seems like each year the offensive numbers and just the overall visual of approach and quality at-bats, they're getting better each year. How would you describe the impact that he has had over these 3 years? Because we know it doesn't happen overnight, but clearly the development has occurred over this time, and it's been going in a positive direction.
Right. Just the way that he explains things, it might be a little bit different than what you might have heard growing up, but he kind of like gets into the nitty gritty. He kind of gets in depth, but then once it rolls around to game time, he takes a step back and just like, okay, we're attacking. I don't know if you guys have ever seen those little like number plate things where it has like the 1, 2, 3, 4 through 7. And it's like, we're just attacking 3 to 5. Like as soon as that pitcher plates the ball, like we're just hacking. So we go through all the technical stuff throughout the week. And then once it's game time, he's like, just go up there and you have a good at bat and you like get after it. So.
You mentioned a little bit about the non-conference schedule you guys played in the preseason. You played a lot of great teams, but you also went a lot of different places. Yes. You went to the Mary Nutter out in California. Mm-hmm. You went to Puerto Vallarta. You went to
Clearwater,
excuse
not
me.
Not out of the country this year.
No, not this year, sorry. Then you went to Clearwater, and you also went to Washington, D.C., like you just mentioned, against Hampton. Not only playing those great teams, but going to all those different places, there's not a lot of time to rest, but that's also a pretty cool experience.
Yeah, it was. It was. It was a very busy early of the season. But again, like I said, we played a lot of good teams, and we got to experience a lot of cool things, especially like our Howard trip. We got to experience what it's like to play there and just being a competitor in a sport where like they're the minority. And then experiencing DC, obviously like with our government being there. So it's kind of cool playing softball, but it's cool to see where softball can bring you when you're not playing.
At least I saw where Howard actually was your all's tour guide throughout Washington.
Yes, yeah.
That must have been very, very awesome.
Yeah, it was. It was.
Well, and you've got more coming up. You've got a road trip, surprise, at Western Kentucky on Thursday, and then a conference slate Saturday, Sunday, Monday, a conference series at South Carolina. What does your team need to do to continue rolling right along? Like we mentioned earlier, 14-game win streak.
Right.
But again, on the road, things are always tough. How do you keep the mojo going?
I think for today, we have an off day, so especially just taking that day off and getting some rest and recovery. And then as soon as it gets back to practice time, like we're full steam ahead. Like we're just getting after it and we're kind of looking back on what we can maybe do better from this past weekend, working that out in practice. But again, once game time comes, like, we're just up there competing.
I love that. Kiki Malloy is our guest. Kiki, before we let you go, Tom, I think it's time. Let's do it. We're going to play a little game.
Okay.
It's time to play some Pepper.
All right.
Here we go.
All right. This is so this is so people can get to know you even better. Okay. First question, favorite place to eat in Knoxville, Tennessee?
I think when I first got here, it was Tupelo Honey, but it's kind of moved to, I would like this place called Pharmacy. Yeah.
All right. That's a new one. So mark that one down, Gray, for next time we go. What's your favorite movie to watch over and over again?
The Notebook. Yeah, it's kind of cliche, or the Kingsman movies, but definitely The Notebook.
Okay, I like that. Did you watch the I'm Just Ken Oscars performance?
No.
Okay.
I haven't even seen the Barbie movie. It's not all rom-coms. They're not all romance movies. It's just.
I was just thinking Ryan Gosling. You know, I'm just trying to.
No, young Ryan Gosling is better than older Ryan Gosling.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah. Hot take.
There we go. Kiki Malloy dropping dimes. Favorite opposing stadium to play in the SEC?
Oh, okay. If I'm going to go for the crowd, Texas A&M was intense. That was intense. But the best stadium, like, overall is probably Florida.
Okay. Do you ever have any crowd interaction out in center field?
Sometimes. Or sometimes when I'm hitting, and then I just like that to fuel my fire. Like, come on, give me all the talk. Give me all the talk.
Like it. What's your favorite song to listen to pregame?
I wouldn't say I have a favorite song. I have just a bunch of different genres. I wouldn't say it's one specific song.
Okay, I like that. What about your comfort TV show? When you need to wind down, what are you turning on?
Grey's Anatomy. I'm going through all the seasons again.
Boy, you could have started your freshman year and you wouldn't be done by now.
No. There's a lot of them out there.
What's one thing in the world that the world should know about your hometown of Woodinville, Washington?
It doesn't just... Oh, I'm sorry if my water cooler is loud. Can you hear that?
Oh, you're okay. Fine.
It doesn't just rain all the time in Washington. And it's actually very beautiful. And if you have a chance to visit, especially during the summer... You should go.
Done. I like it. Who's your goofiest teammate at Tennessee?
Probably Julia. Oh my gosh.
What is your favorite thing about being at Tennessee University, Knoxville, anything about being a Lady Vol?
Just the community that's here to support women's athletics and just the people around you that really want you to excel.
I love that. Phenomenal answer and a phenomenal way to wrap up this interview. Once again, folks, Kiki Malloy has knocked it out of the park. Kiki, thanks for joining us here on It Just Means More Softball. Great to have you on. Good to see you and best of luck the rest of the year.
Thank you guys for having me.
That is the great Kiki Malloy from Tennessee. Just awesome. And I'm glad you got to tell her the story that has made us laugh for like 2 years now.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we can't really use it as a moments clip or anything because Alabama did lose the game. But of an opponent of what, just one of those things when you look back, just the craziness of that surrealness of that entire weekend and that moment just kind of encapsulated the whole thing.
It was great. So Kiki Malloy, thank you for joining us. Shane Schweitzer, thanks for helping us set it all together. And that was amazing. We somehow continue to find these incredible players who are just phenomenal interviews. And Kiki, another great addition to the list. Just amazing.
We are seeing, too, like with the evolution of the game and everything, is how – media savvy players are and how personable they can be in all interview environments. So it's been really cool. Everyone we've talked to so far.
So I will flip the rundown back to the front. The chat is open. Shout out to our pal Fang Nai, good evening. Tom and Gray, hello. If you would like to pop in and ask a question about the SEC, please don't hesitate to do so, because now it's time for Quick Hits. Hear ye, hear ye. The RPI continues to math, and LSU remains number one in the RPI. You've got five SEC teams in the top 10, LSU, Georgia, Alabama, Missouri, Texas A&M. Tennessee is right there at number 11. Mississippi State, Arkansas, Auburn, Florida. The metrics are once again loving the Southeastern Conference, and it helps that teams like Ole Miss, as we'll talk about in just a little bit, are starting to get a little bit of footing now. We saw the Rebels win last night as we record against LSU in Baton Rouge, which, hey, a win over the number one team in the RPI, that's going to bump you up big time.
Yeah, and that's, you know, as we go into further and further into the conference slate, people are going to continue to get the strength of schedule bump, even though they're going to take a few more losses, because when two teams in the same conference play, one of them has to lose. But there are going to be teams that are going to continue to climb. Even say if you lose a series 2-1, if you lose a series 2-1 on the road at a top five team, you still beat a top five team once. So that you'll get a little bump there.
Yeah. And we talked about that post game on CTSN, but we'll also discuss that on the Out of the Box podcast, which all of you can check out when that drops. Sure. Let's start talking about the series individually. We begin on the plains. Arkansas takes 2 of 3 against Auburn. The formula continues to repeat itself for the Tigers. Arkansas wins game 1, 6-1. Game 2, 5-1. Auburn wins game 3, 2-1. And we considered having a chat about Bree Ellis to open this show, because Bree Ellis rakes against her former team is probably the biggest headline out of opening week, or out of this past weekend, I should say, for me. Hit 714, 5 RBIs, 2 home runs, a 3-run homer in the first inning of game 1 off her former teammate, Matty Penta. Just, it kind of set the tone for the entire weekend. And it seemed to be kind of the thing that jolted Arkansas to almost a sweep on the road this past weekend against Auburn.
Yeah, I mean, getting a big hit early on in a series is always big when you're the road team, especially to grab that momentum early on. But the fact that it was Bree Ellis doing it against her former team just added extra to it. And from what I've seen on social media, there's been some rankling going back and forth between the fan bases and Bree herself. But you know, bottom line, a really good player just made a really big play. And it helped Arkansas. I think it probably might have even taken a little bit of the invincibility factor away from Matty Penta there early on. You know, when an opponent has such a, you know, a dominant ace, and you can get to her so quickly, that it can do a lot for you for the entire weekend. But then kudos to Penta for being able to come back in the third game.
Yeah, and we'll talk about Matty Penta in just a moment. There is some concern with Robin Heron and her possible injury from this past weekend. I've not seen an update about that, but she only threw 4 1/3 in the series. Morgan Linestock had to step up, and that team ERA for Arkansas currently sits at 190. Linestock and Heron, I've mistyped it on the outline. They do not have the same number of innings pitched, but there's only a 6-inning difference between the two. And Linestock has pitched well, but that role might have to increase even more if Heron has to miss an extended amount of time.
Yeah, especially considering the fact that the circle is still your main area of concern if you're Arkansas, and now you lose one of your main arms. We don't know the length or severity of the injury, but if there is some time that she's going to be out, that puts a lot more on Linestock in particular, and maybe put a little bit more even on that offense, which is, you know, it's coming around really well, and we know it has a lot of talent, but it might have to put up a little bit more even moving forward.
Yeah, Kenny Miller might be one of those contenders at the end of the year for SEC Freshman of the Year, hitting .431 on the season overall and having a great opening weekend of conference play. Just a reminder, everybody, remember this. The SEC Awards, postseason player of the year, all SEC team, freshman of the year, pitcher of the year. Those are decided by SEC stats. So we had this conversation a couple years ago when it was the Kayla Kowalik versus Bailey Hemphill number. I would cite these stats for Hemphill. People would say, no, Kowalik is ranked ahead here. And overall, that might be true, but SEC stats are what matters for those awards. So keep that in mind. I mentioned that also as a preface to talk about Maddie Pinta, last year's SEC Pitcher of the Year, who is still really darn good, but she kind of has a game one problem. We've seen teams not only hit her, but hit her out of the park to start off series so far in conference play. Missouri did it. Now Arkansas has done it. The is at 128. That's very good. 8-4 record. She's got 82 innings, next highest to Shelby Lowe at 23 1/3. Again, it's going to be on Maddie Pinta to see how this Auburn season goes. Right now, we are watching the season kind of play out like we expected. And for Auburn, that's not necessarily a good thing.
Yeah. The fact that she has that many more innings than anybody else, the fact she's already at 82 on the year, does lead to wonder, is she going to be able to hold up throughout the entire season? Not that, you know, she'll miss time, but, you know, will she run out of gas? Will, you know, it be tough for her to be as sharp in the most important part of the season, which is the end of the year and postseason? That's kind of what happened to her last year. She ran out of gas a little bit. And unfortunately, we have not seen the Lowe's and Weitra's step up and take any of that workload off of her. We'll see. If anybody can do it, Maddie Pinta is one of the people that could do it. But that was the issue last season.
Let's move on to the series that we saw in person in Athens, Georgia against Alabama. Georgia won game one, Weathers Classic, came down to one hit affairs in the SEC. Game two, Georgia flexed and won 11-3 in five innings. Game three went to the Tide. We'll talk much more about Alabama on the Out of the Box podcast, so check that out. But I want to make sure that we discuss what Georgia accomplished. And I should note, both teams won midweeks against high-quality ACC teams. But man, this Georgia offense, what impressed me the most is not only their ability to cash in on opportunities, kind of Sunday notwithstanding, that was a 1-for-12 day with runners in scoring position. That was a little out of character, I would say. But you've got somebody like Sarah Mosley, who leads the conference in RBIs. Jada Kearney is a homer waiting to happen. And then really this weekend, while those two had moments, it was kind of everybody else who really provided the offensive consistency, which struck me as maybe the most impressive thing I saw about the Dogs this past weekend.
Yeah, there was at no point when, if you're calling the game for the opponent of Georgia, can you take a breath? Can you be like, okay, we got past her, but because somebody else is right behind her? Because we were saying in that seventh inning of the third game, we're like, got Sarah Mosley out. Oh, here comes the SEC leader in home runs. It's like there is no chance to take a breath if you're the opponent there. So just a really potent lineup from top to bottom. The best one I've seen all year from that Alabama has played against. So, Georgia was very, very impressive, even down to the 9-0 hitter. Dallas Goodnight was on base the entire weekend. They were a just as advertised offensive team and got some really good innings in the circle as well. So as complete of a team as I've seen this season.
And they do one of the things that Oklahoma does really well, which is they put pressure on you even with the outs. The outs are productive. The outs are loud. The outs scare you when you play Georgia. And even in game two, early before it kind of spiraled out of control, Georgia was barreling everything. And they actually did a little bit better of it, a job of it early in game one than they did in game three. Obviously, Alabama won that game. But Georgia had a lot of loud outs all weekend. And that's the kind of stuff that freaks out pitching coaches, because good teams are going to get the hits, but it's when they get out, it's still a good piece of hitting. That's when you know you're facing an offense that can do pretty much anything they want against you.
And also their response stat and their anti-response stat is outstanding too. So yeah, it's hard to gain momentum away from them because they're always responding. If you put runs up, they're going to put runs up. The only time Alabama was able to do it was in that third game when they put up a 5 spot in the fourth inning. But even then, Georgia just kept chipping away, and it ended up being a 5-4 game, and Alabama had to get a strikeout with the bases loaded to end it in the seventh. So that they are just a relentless team that will just continue to put pressure on you inning in and inning out.
I want to make sure we mention Lily Backus as well. She was the most impressive pitcher I saw this weekend from the Dogs. Walters had good moments. Kerpik certainly had good moments, although she struggled a little bit more in game three. But Backus was consistent each and every day that we watched her from up in the booth, Tom. And I was very, very impressed by her changeup. I know that that's one of the pitches that our pal Brady Vernon has talked about. And that was one of the things that that has really kind of set her apart this year. But when that pitch is on, it's nasty and it's impossible to read. And Lily Backus has the potential to be that arm that Georgia relies on. They've got a three-headed monster, but sometimes you need somebody that you can count on in the big moments. And Lily Backus is that person.
Yeah, she certainly looked to be that she's going to be the go-to. And the fact that in game one, we were kind of surprised at the time that when Lily Backus came in, to get the save because she was about to face a bunch of righties after Alabama had gone through the lefties. But that didn't seem to faze her. She came in and really had Alabama batters off kilter since she came in. So she's outstanding. If she can continue to throw that changeup for a strike consistently enough that she can base the rest of her pitch sequences off a strike that you have to try to swing at on a changeup. She's going to be very, very tough to get to handle.
I'll give you a couple seconds to talk about Alabama. Again, we went very in depth on the Out of the Box podcast. So if you want more, check that out. But Tom, the big story probably is dadgum Caleb Beaver is just gritty, and Alabama found a way on Sunday. But I left that game seeing something that was more intangible than physical from Caleb Beaver that showed me what she can do the rest of the year.
Absolutely. I mean, take a look at not only what she did against Georgia, but what she did against Florida State as well. She was pitching extremely well, but then suffered the injury to her non-pitching hand. She fought through it, was able to pitch with it on Friday and Sunday, pitched well on Friday, made one mistake. Georgia, because they're Georgia, took advantage of it, hit a three-run homer, and ended up winning the game. But to come back on Sunday and have that type of attitude of I'm going to go out there, it frankly reminded me of Montana Fouts. It's like we're going to go out there, and I am not going to allow us to lose this game. You guys give me enough runs. We're I'm going to hold them down. And that strikeout with the bases loaded to Fields was just as gritty and gutty as you will see. Gutsy to throw the pitch that she threw. It was ball four, but it was one that Fields couldn't hold off on. Really, really impressive. She kind of has a combination of Alexis Osorio and Montana Fouts to where, Osorio would get herself into a little danger, might walk the bases loaded, but then she'd get out of it. And then Fouts having that bulldog attitude. So Caleb Beaver definitely willed Alabama to a win there. You got enough offensively that fourth inning in game three, the best Alabama has been able to pass the baton in a while with the at-bats. The fact they didn't stop with just the one home run, they kept going, kept getting runs. You ended up needing all five of them. So I think if you're Alabama, you can feel good. In the last seven games, you have beaten Florida. You've won at Florida State, and you've won a game at Georgia. There's a lot of positives that have happened this past week. Don't think about the fact you lost two series. You got some good wins, and now you can continue to get better as the season goes on. I think if you're Alabama, you feel pretty good about how the week went.
Speaking of good wins, let's talk about the Ole Miss Rebels. Oh, man. Last night, let me tell you, everybody, I'm not going to spoil all of my fellow voters. But I had LSU number one on my ballot. I was ready. I was ready to press send.
Everyone finally jumped on board with me.
It was time. I was ready. We'll talk about LSU's midweek win over Texas in just a minute as well. But then all of a sudden, Ole Miss finds a couple runs late in the game and then busts it open in the seventh inning and goes on to win game two. They're playing game three right now. It is 0-0 in the top of the second as we record. I was very, very struck by what Ole Miss was able to string together against Sidney Berzon. They weren't facing, somebody random. They were facing the purported ace on this LSU pitching staff. And that was impressive to me. LSU, very close to being number one, folks. And maybe, I don't know. Hey, maybe one of the polls will make that move. Maybe some people turned off their TVs at 7 o'clock Central Time before that game went final. And obviously a rough ending to a great week, but just a lot to take away from these two teams after what we've seen the last 7 days.
I think it just showed the depth of this conference. I mean, I don't think it's being disrespectful to say that Ole Miss is number 13 out of 13 as it stands right now in this conference. And they just went on the road and, you know, and beat LSU, beat the undefeated team at the time. So that you can't not play your best and win in this league. And LSU had kind of an off day. Ole Miss had a really good day, and that's what happened. That's what we talked to with Patrick Murphy in our pregame interview on Sunday about that very thing. If you're just a little bit off, you know, somebody like Ole Miss can beat LSU, or if you're just a little bit off, a score can get really ugly in a game. And that's what happens in this league.
I flashed the question on the screen from Fang Nye. With Mississippi's win last night, have they climbed out of the basement of the SEC power rankings? I don't think so, which is like a bummer for them, but also, like you said, just a reflection of how deep and solid this conference is, but also how everybody who's in it acknowledges, hey, anything can happen at any time that doesn't necessarily reflect the larger picture. One game is one game. We have to wait for the full product and evaluate everything that we have when we look at those types of things.
If they win tonight, we'll discuss it.
Yes. And let's see. Nope, still 0-0. So we'll keep you up to date. Right. One thing about LSU, the midweek win and midday midweek win over Texas, 7-4, jumping out with that 5 spot in the first inning. Very impressive. After the first inning, I said, all right, I'm in. LSU, number one. And I thought Berzon pitched really well that day, even as Texas kind of did what we talked about with Georgia in game 3, was kind of chipping away and getting closer and getting closer. LSU was able to find the hits late and the runs late to keep them at bay. And Berzon was lights out the last 2 innings to where the Longhorns never really had a shot in their last 6 outs to play with.
And what a cool thing to bring in a bunch of second graders that are going to be screaming and yelling throughout the entire game. That's going to be quite atmosphere. We deal with that with Alabama women's basketball when they have the 4th grade fast break. And we know how fun and cool that atmosphere is. So to do that, but to do that also facing a top 5 team in Texas, that is it was a little risky, but it ended up going in LSU's favor. And yeah, scoring 5 in that first inning, really, really impressive by LSU. And I think that answered some of the questions, because people were saying, yeah, LSU, they're undefeated, but you know, they haven't had the toughest non-conference schedule. Have they really established themselves as a national championship type contender?
They hadn't had a ton of style points up to then either.
No, but to be able to do that and to win it rather handily against a team like Texas is very, very impressive.
Yeah, shout out to the kids at Alabama women's basketball. The most I've ever been scared in probably the last 3 years was walking out of a tunnel. I had just run an errand and I was walking out and all the children are seated. And all of a sudden the song Ski Yee starts playing.
Look
and
out.
Every child in that building screams it. And I leapt out of my shoes. I was not expecting it. So
they get lit, fam. That's the kids say.
Speaking of getting lit up.
Oh.
Ayo. Texas A&M crushed Mississippi State in game 1 of the series in Starkville. And we were sitting there thinking, oh my gosh, what has happened to Mississippi State? A&M, how for real are they? They won game 2. Game 3 turned into just crushing the ball on both sides. Madison Kennedy is right now unstoppable offensively. But Texas A&M showed a lot going on the road and winning a series and coming this close to a sweep against a team that I think is pretty good in Mississippi State. The Aggies are now officially entering contender range in this conference.
Yeah, I'm going to have to jump on board the Texas A&M bandwagon, because 2 weeks in a row, I was like, I'm not sure if I'm in on Texas A&M. I picked them to lose the series both last week and the week before, and then they sweep South Carolina and come very close to sweeping Mississippi State. So, yeah, Texas A&M proving me and everybody else wrong so far here through 6 games in the conference.
So first, Rebecca said, no, Tom, with love, LOL. Then she also pointed out, yeah, Emily Kennedy is lethal, and she currently has a 1.10 ERA. Got touched up a little bit in game three by Mississippi State, but she leads the SEC in wins. She's thrown almost 90 innings. My concern is we're not seeing a ton of everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
Ackerman and Leavitt have thrown three innings each in conference play. I think that they're pretty solid pitchers, and I'm a little surprised that Kennedy and Brooke Vestal have had to kind of carry the load, so to speak. But this is an A&M team that's got offense for days. They got bats up and down or hitting the ball well. Trinity Cannon, Jazz Hill, Allie Enright, who did not have any residual effects after what appeared to be a strange injury rounding the bases on a home run. A&M seems for real. And for Mississippi State, it was really big to get game three. Just really, really big. Madison Kennedy is now hitting 444 with 35 RBIs and 11 homers, just trying to chase down Jada Kearney. They've got 10 hitters hitting above 300. They just have the consistency for the offense that makes them dangerous. And if you get a good outing out of Josie Maren and Aspen Wesley, which is always possible, Mississippi State can beat near anybody in America.
Yeah, I mean, they are a team that has been – more consistent than I was expecting them to be. And because of being able to have that many hitters hitting over 300 to go along with Madison Kennedy. So it's not just her. It's the entire lineup that's doing so much. Mississippi State is a good team. And I think they've gone from a team that, well, we think they're not going to get swept. They may be able to, you know, they should at least be able to get one from everybody on their schedule, to a team that, you know, they can legitimately win a lot of these series they have left on their slate. So Mississippi State's quality team, Texas A&M, also a very quality team, as we just discussed. And we'll talk with Tori Vidalis on the Out of the Box podcast a little bit more about the Aggies.
We also have already talked with Kiki Malloy about Tennessee and Missouri. The Lady Vols swept the Tigers. Again, if you're, for whatever reason, just hearing this and you haven't heard that interview, go back and listen to Kiki. She's phenomenal. She is now just absolutely ripping the cover off the ball, hitting 450 with 18 RBIs. Pickens has a 0.55 ERA. Gottschall is just absolutely terrible comparatively at 125. I mean, that 1-2 punch might be the best in the SEC as it stands right now. And to do what they did to Missouri, a team that I think is pretty good, is as big a statement as I've seen from any team in this conference so far through league play.
Yeah, Missouri has been a top 10 team in the nation, you know, and still RPI-wise, they still are. But, yeah, to go in or to go against Missouri, yeah, it's at home, but still, that's impressive to get a big sweep over the Tigers there. And, yeah, Pickens Gottschall as dominant as a 1-2 as you're going to see in this league. And, you know, even Gottschall's ERA is a little bit elevated because of one bad outing, basically. So she is outstanding. Pickens has kind of found her form that she had in the first month or two of the season last year when she burst on the scene. So they're going to get great outings in the circle much more often than not. And then what people like Malloy and this offense are doing, when you said Malloy's batting average this month, I almost fell out of my chair. What was that batting average again this month?
595.
That's ludicrous. Just ridiculous.
Remember on this podcast, we were like, yeah, Kiki Malloy.
What's wrong with Kiki?
Turn it up a little bit.
Yeah.
She did.
She said bet, as the kids say.
My gosh. You're such a youth, Tom. From the Missouri standpoint, Lauren Krings currently sitting with a 2.83 ERA is a concern. We've always talked about Lauren Krings, probably not one of the elite pitchers, but one you can always count on, is very, very solid, very, very good. She did not have a good weekend in Knoxville. And right now it's kind of reverting back to what the problem was last year. Offensively, Honnold and Laird are dynamic and two of the best bats in this conference, but the numbers behind are starting to dip a little bit, and that's where Missouri gets in trouble.
Yeah, this weekend is kind of one of the reasons why I haven't fully jumped on the Missouri bandwagon for what they've done. They've had some really impressive wins here in the non-conference, but coming now against teams that kind of have the book on Krings and kind of have the book on what the Tigers have, we're seeing, you know, a little bit of an issue for Missouri. Now, that being said, kind of similar to what we said with Alabama, Missouri, a tough start to their conference slate, having to go to Tennessee early on. So I don't think you give up on Missouri. You know, it's a bad weekend against a good team, but there are some question marks moving forward.
Talk about prep. Matty Penta, Carlin Pickens, Peyton Gottschall, first 2 weeks of conference play.
Whoo!
Ooh, here we go. Look at this. We love when the commenters get in on the action. Oh, Ole Miss up 3-0 in the second on LSU. So Fang Nye, ask that question maybe later on in the show. We might have a different answer.
Right. Now, again, like we thought, oh, Texas A&M is about to sweep Mississippi State because they were up 3-0. But so LSU still has time. But, yeah, if Ole Miss wins the series at LSU, that's kind of a shift in a lot of parameters.
Yeah, we will have a little reevaluation period on one of our various podcasts, I'm sure. South Carolina, it was looking good. You know, they beat Boston U, they beat Minnesota, they'd had a good week, and then Sunday was a coming, and the wins were a going. Just losses to NC State and Northwestern. NC State a shutout from Madison Insko, who pitched phenomenally. Northwestern was able to hold on, even though South Carolina got a run in the seventh. Of a team batting average is at 258. That is not good. That is last in the SEC. The team ERA is very good. Vaughter and Marjetko and Jory Hurd, too. They're pitching really well, but they're not being perfect. And right now, when they're not being perfect, the South Carolina offense does not have their backs to the extent that they probably need to. And that's led to the Gamecocks dropping out of the Softball America top 25.
Yeah, you know, I thought we'd see more offensively from South Carolina overall. Vaughter is still... She's been good, but she hasn't been quite as dominant as I thought she was going to be. So it's just, it hasn't all quite come together for South Carolina, which has led to games like we had on Saturday. And that was kind of the one issue that we had for South, or that I had especially for South Carolina. I thought they were going to be very good, but were they, was everybody going to be able to gel? You were relying on a lot of transfers and new faces. They're all really good, but will they all gel to come in together? And maybe there's been a little where there hasn't had as much gelling as we thought there was going to be. Not, you know, you don't shut down the program because you lose Northwestern. Northwestern's a good team, but you know, NC State's a surprise, and you just kind of you had a tough week if you're the Gamecocks.
Yeah, and let me correct myself real quick. They did not fall out. They dropped to number 25 in the top 25 poll. There was discussion for that final spot. So it's, you know, it was close, mm-hmm. but the Gamecocks did hold on. And yeah, I mean, a loss to Northwestern. NC State is much better this year. They've gotten some votes. So I'm not necessarily decrying these as failure losses that should shutter the program. Of course not. I would never say that. But still, South Carolina is just not doing what they need to do. And it's led to where it feels like this weekend, when they play Tennessee, and we'll talk about that a little bit, will kind of be put up or shut up weekend. Like, are you actually a contender? Are you actually someone that we should be talking about as a threat in this conference? Or did we just buy in a little bit too much? I think this weekend is probably where we get our answers.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. All right. So one other team to talk about before we discuss what's to come this weekend, Kentucky stepped out of conference. Things were going well. They were winning against Ohio State. I got home, I made a pizza, I looked at the app, and they lost. Kentucky dropped 12-6, the finale of the weekend, to an Ohio State team that has struggled. The team ERA at 3.04 is a big concern. And yeah, especially when you've got situations where you turn to Stephanie Schoonover, like against Ohio State, like against LSU in that third game, and she's not able to get it done. That's the arm that you were counting on. So Kentucky being an enigma, we might kind of just know what they are, and the answer probably is not what Kentucky fans were hoping for.
Yeah, unfortunately for them, I think if we do move Ole Miss out of the basement, I think Kentucky might be moving in. You know,
a team that has beaten Stanford twice, by
yes,
the way.
Right. That happened this year, like within a month. So, yeah, it's the fact that you can't just turn over to Stephanie Schoonover and she, you know, calms everything down in those type of games like the loss to Ohio State is the most concerning thing. You know, the offense has done well for the most part. You know, they've a lot of these games, the weird ones that they've lost, they've been like huge shootouts. They've been like 12-10, those type of games, you know, 12-6. Normally, if you score six runs against Ohio State, you should win the game.
Yeah.
That shouldn't even be the question, but you get doubled up instead. So, yeah, Schoonover, you know, we had thought about her as an elite pitcher in this league. Maybe she's just good and not elite.
Yeah, Aaron Koffel continues to be elite. And actually, the offense, like you talked about, they are producing. You know, you've got Riley Smith hitting well. Taylor Ebbs is hitting well. You've got people up and down the lineup who are doing the things you want to do, but just the pitching piece has not quite been there, which makes the upcoming weekend a little difficult for the Wildcats. And, Tom, I think it's time we do indeed look ahead. So here's what's due up in the SEC. Midweek mayhem. Woo. Three big games. Missouri at Kansas. Welcome to the top 25, Jayhawks. I know you're in there because I fought for you to be as high as possible. I was the highest on the Jayhawks among the ballots. South Carolina at Clemson. Rivalry renewed. Could we see a Vaughter versus Cagle, both hitting and pitching matchup? That would be immensely fun. And Texas A&M at Texas State, who's also in the top 25. Jessica Mullins has taken down some teams throughout her career. That is not one that the Aggies can sleepwalk through at all. For a Wednesday, those are three pretty phenomenal matchups with teams in this league playing in them.
Yeah, quite a slate of big rivalries. Missouri, Kansas. I don't know if you know this. Missouri and Kansas, they like fought a war. Like a legit battle. Not like recently, but it happened. So, yeah, so that is it's going to be very interesting and definitely the best Kansas has been in a long, long time against a Missouri team that is licking their wounds a little bit, but a very good team there too. So a high-quality matchup there in that matchup. And then South Carolina-Clemson. If you're South Carolina and you want to prove everybody wrong and say, no, we are a good team, we are an elite team, go to Clemson and win. I think that'll cure a lot of ills there if you're South Carolina. And, yeah, like you said, Texas A&M, you better bring everything for Mullins and Texas State.
Yeah, I mentioned that the series against Tennessee's put up or shut up. Really, it starts Wednesday in that game against Clemson because Clemson has not been as lights out this year as, frankly, I was anticipating. I had them in the World Series. They were one of the first teams I wrote down when I was making my preseason predictions, and they have not looked particularly dominant.
It's really a similar situation to what Alabama had last week in the midweek going to Florida State. I think for both the teams, you know, Alabama had just come off of losing the series to Florida. You know, they need to play well in that game against Florida State, who is having their issues too. And Alabama was able to do that. We'll see if South Carolina can do the same against Clemson.
Conference play continues. Before that, we will send a shout out to Alabama, Virginia Tech coming up this weekend. Couple matchups on SEC Network Plus and the Crimson Tide Sports Network. We will be represented on each, and it should be a ton of fun to watch Emma Limley and Lindsey Grind and the gang and that fantastic Tech offense come to Tuscaloosa, and we get to see our buddy Pete DeMore, and that'll be a lot of fun. Highly recommend everybody track that. But we've got six conference series, Tom, that are just very interesting. LSU at Missouri, Mississippi State at Arkansas, Georgia at Ole Miss, Auburn at Texas A&M, Kentucky at Florida, and Tennessee at South Carolina for Saturday, Sunday, Monday. We'll do our locks in just a minute, but just initial thoughts on a slate that could either supply some of the teams up at the top of the standings with bigger cushion or really bring everybody else back in the fold.
Yeah, we were kind of discussing this a little bit off air, but it's like, you kind of look at it and you say, well, this might not be a weekend for a lot of chaos in this league, but, you know, kind of the definition of the chaos is you don't expect it. And, you know, I don't think anyone expected Ole Miss to be giving LSU everything they wanted in this series that they're currently playing right now. So, this one, it looks like you could maybe go kind of chalk and make good picks, but I would not be surprised if there are two or three surprises here this weekend in the conference, because that's just the way the SEC is this year. The fact that we're trying to pick it, I don't know if we can.
Arkansas, All right. How big of a contender are you? If you're a conference contender, I think you can sweep Mississippi State this weekend. But Mississippi State's also a team kind of flowing around in the middle. Do they want to make a statement on the road? I don't know. How about Missouri hosting LSU? You've got to come back from what happened last weekend. And this is as tough a way to kick off conference play with these back-to-back series as you can. But, I mean, the Tigers can turn everything upside down with a series win at home against LSU.
Yeah, they could. And we know traveling to Como is crazy no matter what. As we're seeing in people are talking in the comments, the weather is always an issue in Como. So that, you know, will that have an effect in the game? It's a really tough place to play. And especially if LSU is not able to come back and beat Ole Miss here in this game, they'll be kind of licking their wounds a little bit heading to Como.
Yeah. We mentioned maybe not a lot of chaos, but the three teams right now who a lot of us perceive as the top three in this league, LSU, Georgia, Tennessee, they're all on the road.
Yeah.
So they're not all going to sweep, most likely.
No.
Going to happen somewhere, which leads me, Tom, to asking for your lock for this week. I missed mine this past week. You got yours.
Boom. Well
done. So you want to tell the people what they should count on this upcoming weekend?
It comes down to two series for me. I'm looking at either Georgia at Ole Miss or Kentucky at Florida. The issue I have with Georgia and Ole Miss is because what we're seeing with what Ole Miss is doing with LSU and coming back home. So the question there is it a 2-1 or is it a 3-0? So I am going to instead go to the Kentucky-Florida series in Gainesville, and I am going to say Florida sweeps Kentucky as my lock.
Wow. Owen Wilson voice.
Yeah.
Interest. Oh boy, that wouldn't be good.
No, that's not good for anybody else.
No, and nor for the Wildcats for sure.
No, it's not good for Kentucky. It's not good for anybody else that are wanting teams like Florida not to run and hide right now.
Yeah, I would say if LSU comes back to win tonight, I think that my lock will be Missouri 2-1, but I obviously don't know that as we record. So I think I'm going to go Arkansas 2-1 over Mississippi State. That feels about right. I think the biggest question, obviously, is what the pitching plan will be for Arkansas with Heron potentially missing time. Reese Burline has had some availability issues. Line stock has been good, but can she beat an SEC team twice in a row on a weekend? We'll see, especially with a hugely increased workload like she will have against a Mississippi State team that is as consistent offensively as any team in this league. So I like Arkansas to win the series. I think Arkansas will win the series, but I think that Mississippi State has a chance to prove me wrong in a way that completely changes everything in this conference.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, that's all I've got. We've got one comment in. Fang Nye, I think Tennessee will sweep South Carolina on the road.
I could see that, but that would also be just incredibly disappointing for South Carolina.
And it would almost end the SEC race for half the teams in the conference.
Right. I mean, Georgia and Tennessee, frankly, need some losses. And Florida, too, at this point, for all of us, if we want to have a fun race to the end.
Content.
That's all we want. It, you know, as cool as it is, like when Tiger Woods wins by 10, there's nobody, like somebody else would like to play.
Someone make a birdie.
Yeah.
That's all we want. Any final thoughts before we wrap the show? Thank you, by the way, to everybody who's tuned in.
Yeah, for sure. That was, got a lot of comments today, which we appreciate. Thank you so much to everybody. And there's been just so much happening. Oh.
I didn't thumbs down. I don't know what happened.
Who did that? Horns down to you. They're not here yet, so I can do that still.
No, it's fine. We have like three more months before that's outlawed.
Pixelated. When I do that.
No, but it was a great show. And thank you to Kiki Malloy and Shane for helping us set everything up. Kiki was amazing. And I can't wait to see what player we cook up next week for It Just Means More Softball. Because, Tom, like we talked about, based on what I'm looking at, it could be a standard show. It could be a show of true insanity, depending on how this weekend goes.
As per usual, we'll be right about some things and really, really wrong about others, and we'll talk about it. It'll be fun.
Yeah, that's what makes it great. For my partner, Tom Canterbury, I'm Gray Robertson. Remember, like, share, subscribe. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. Do us all a favor and make it happen. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to It Just Means More Softball, part of the Softball America Podcast Network. We'll see you next week, everybody.